Det gleder jeg meg.
Ja, ja.
Okay, we're gonna get started. Okay. Good morning to everyone in the room, and good morning to many of you who are going to be watching us or watching us at this point elsewhere. I am delighted to welcome you here today to discuss Global Fertilizer Challenge, to discuss with this esteemed panel what has transpired in the world of fertilizers over the past year, but most importantly, what we are going to see going forward. If I asked you this time last year whether fertilizer would be an acceptable dinner conversation, you would probably laugh at me, because while it is an acceptable dinner conversation for me running the Fertilizer Association, it was not a topic for some for anybody else pretty much, and how the world has changed. What we have seen is the impact of what it takes to take one actor out of the supply chain and what it means for everybody else in the world, especially for emerging markets. But also, we have seen what the impact is of sustainability of our industry. And let's not forget that just a year and a half ago, we had a food system summit where we discussed everything that we need to do about sustainability of agriculture, including our industry. So today we are sitting here to discuss what needs to happen in global fertilizer markets, in global fertilizer industry. Who are the actors who can make a difference? What are the policies that can make a real difference? And what needs to happen to move the needle on food security in the world? I will introduce the speakers to you, and I'll ask each of them to do a couple minutes introductory remarks, after which we are going to have a free flow conversation. So delighted to have right next to me Rick Duke, Deputy Special Presidential Envoy for Climate from the United States, Minister Tvinnerheim, Minister of International Development of Norway, Svein Tore Holsether, Chief Executive and President of Yara International, and Roger Forres, President of Global Growth and Opportunity at Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. Rick, why don't you get us started?
Thank you. It's so pleased to be talking about fertilizer with you again. It is a favorite topic these days, given the centrality in ensuring that we are doing what's required to manage through the climate transition that we need while also ensuring food security, and all the more important to be grappling with these questions in the current era where we are grappling with the shocks from the illegal invasion of Ukraine by Russia. So I want to just give a sense of the magnitude of the challenge and opportunity here in grappling with fertilizer and its efficiency. When we look globally, we see that there are over 800 million food insecure people in the world today, and on the order of 50 million suffering from real crisis in terms of food insecurity and worse. And so it is a very real humanitarian imperative that we grapple with these questions. And of course, when the price of fertilizer increases in an OECD country, it is a challenge. When the price of fertilizer increases, and it is, of course, a globally traded commodity, it can be a real crisis in countries that suffer from inadequate fertilizer application today, such as in sub-Saharan Africa, and where it is a key determinant of productivity of their food systems and related food security. So it is essential that we work together as a global community to manage this together. And when we do so, when we work on things that enhance soil health and that enhance the efficiency of fertilizer use and reduce that 50% of fertilizer applied in richer countries that is often wasted and ends up as one form or another of effluent or N2O greenhouse gas emissions, which by the way account for 6% of global greenhouse gas emissions, most of which comes from fertilizer manufacture or waste. When we do that together, we are helping on addressing these twin challenges and opportunities of food and climate security. And it is therefore with great enthusiasm that the United States has joined alongside Norway and Germany, the Netherlands, and the EU to pull together a global fertilizer challenge which squarely tackles this agenda. And we in the United States have incredible investment and knowledge of our own agricultural systems. Our own U.S. Department of Agriculture has intensively studied what it requires to measure and manage fertilizer efficiency in our own systems within our major agricultural sector. We are now working with these partners and the philanthropic sector and others to leverage that knowledge in new geographies, in a global scale. And so we are hopeful that this is something which will allow us to get to a place where we have reduced those losses of fertilizer in places where it is sometimes used less efficiently than we would ideally want to see, and ensure that we're managing over time to have adequate supply and increase supply even in places where it is not yet used sufficiently, like most of the poorer countries in the world. So thrilled to be here and thrilled to be working together with all of you.
Great, thank you, Rick. So thank you for so eloquently describing the challenge of providing fertilizers for food security, but also highlighting what it takes to do it responsibly and sustainably. And I would submit that there is no better time than a time of high prices to focus on sustainability, because sustainability goes with basic economy on the farm. So I'll pick it up later. So I'd like to go now to Minister Twinerheim. You have joined Global Fertilizer Challenge as a country, and you also have some personal experience with agri and farming. Please tell us what Norway is doing, and tell us a bit about your thoughts on this Global Fertilizer Challenge.
Thank you. Maybe I should use the mic, or?
Yours probably is working.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
Okay,
yours
you're
doing.
Thank you.
Come hear us, let us know, okay?
Thank you, and you said it at the beginning. You know, who would have thought I would sit here? This is my first event at Davos. This is my first time at Davos. Who would have thought that, as Minister of International Development, I would be invited to Davos to talk about fertilizers? Who would have thought that Antonio Guterres, the Secretary General of the UN, opened his speech at the General Assembly this autumn, talking about fertilizers? So it just goes to prove the urgency of the matter. And I'm absolutely thrilled to be here discussing this topic. The UN released a crisis report less than a year ago, warning the world that, you know, up till now in the history, the world has produced enough food to feed the global population. It has been a matter of distribution and price. We might face a situation now where we simply cannot produce enough food for the world's population. Now that's a game changer, and that's where the fertilizers come in. And Norway is excited to join the US, other countries, and the private sector in the Global Fertilizer Challenge. We are investing some $15 million US dollars over 3 years now, and focusing on a couple of issues in particular. First of all, we support the African Development Bank's fertilizer mechanism. They are really stepping up now on making sure that fertilizer is distributed, especially to small-scale farmers around Africa. So that's one focus. And the second is on soil health, especially in sub-Saharan Africa. We know that, you know, the global food production, the global food system is broken. And in Africa, the potential, the resources for stepping up on production is immense. But the soil degradation is horrific. We need to do a huge task together to map the soil health in sub-Saharan Africa. And together with Yara and other actors, we are setting up a soil health platform, that's the word, right? Which will be an open public good. Information about the soil quality specifically in the sub-Saharan region, which will make it possible to use precision agriculture to tailor-make mineral fertilizers or organic fertilizers for the quality of the soil. So that's it's great for the environment, it's great for increasing income for small-scale producers, and it's a great opportunity for private sector as well. So I'm very excited about that. I'll stop.
Thank you, Minister Twinerheim. So it's very exciting that a development minister is talking about fertilizers. because having seen development on the ground for the last 25 years or so, this was not a topic that we would talk about with development ministers. Thank you for bringing it up. And on soil health, I think it's safe to say that many of us didn't think about it until about a year ago. And this is another topic that needs to be prominent when it comes to discussion of global public goods. And I'm going to pick it up with Roger afterwards. But first, I'm going to go to Svein-Tore Holsether. Svein-Tore, you are one of the largest producers, but you're also seeing small-scale farmers on the ground. Tell us a bit of a dilemma that's happening in the industry today.
Well, as already has been pointed out, the importance of fertilizer and how that's risen to the top of the agenda worldwide and also here at in Davos this year, half of the world's food production is because of fertilizer. And the awareness of what fertilizer really is, it is nutrition for plants. And when we remove crops, we remove nutrients, and then we need to replace them. And this is why it's so important that we focus on soil health, so that we add the right nutrients, so that we have a healthy soil. If we have a healthy soil, we have a healthy crop, we take care of biodiversity, we have more efficient farming, which means that we can farm on less area, turn back to nature and so on. So this is an incredibly important product, and up until now a well-hidden secret within the industry. So now that we have this awareness, even with this tragic backdrop, let's use that to also drive the industry forward to be more focused on both the impact and the emissions of producing fertilizers. It's a major emission, so we need to reduce that. But it's also about the in-field emissions, and that's where the majority of the emissions are. And here it's important not only to focus on large-scale farmers, but also small-scale farmers and help them with the right use of fertilizer. And here technology has really been a game changer. Knowledge that was only available to large-scale farmers in the past is now through either smartphones, but even with a normal phone, you can get competence and knowledge about how to use fertilizer, when to use it, and so on, right in the hand of the smallholder farmers, so that we can help them to raise productivity as well. We see the importance of that in order to create more resilient farming also for smallholder farmers. And here we're not talking about incremental increases in yields. Minister Twinnerham and I, we were in Kenya just a couple of months ago, and we could see it firsthand for coffee farmers that we're not talking 10% increase. We're talking about doubling of the yields in the first season, and we can do even more than that as well. But equally important, if you don't have the right application of fertilizer and nutrition, then you're also more vulnerable to climate change. These farmers were farming maize on the side as a food crop, and because of climate change, first drought, then flood, not only did they have an impact on their maize yields, they lost the whole harvest. There was nothing there. And that's why we need to be even more aware of this and to create more resilient soil to withstand the climate change that is also coming now.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Svein-Tore. So what is really important to take out of this is really we need to start thinking about fertilizers as a service industry. With a precision like we took to all the other industries, I think we need to get that precision to agriculture, because we are talking about the opportunity to do it precisely to the soil that we need to get the outcomes that we need, which is healthier soils. We can pick that up in the next round, but I'd like to go to Roger now. So Roger, global public goods, your foundation does a lot of work on global public goods, food, health, you name it. You have a great platform, and we have worked a number of projects together. How do you see fertilizers as a topic in the global growth and opportunity business that you run? And what would you recommend to this panel and to the world in terms of next steps to make sure that we don't have food issues?
Yeah, thanks for the question. I mean, from the Gates Foundation point of view, if we look at just in my lifetime, so I'm almost 60, we have gone from adequately feeding around 900 million people to adequately feeding 7 billion people, or a little over. And that has been done with only a 40% increase in land. And that intensification actually resulted in the greatest growth in productivity and the number of people coming, the greatest number of people coming out of poverty in the history of the world. And so agriculture has been one of the biggest engines of driving people out of poverty that we've seen. And that is not going to happen without, so far, inorganic fertilizer as being one of the key drivers of that. Now, we say that, and then we're like, okay, how do we also deal, because you just heard a big announcement at COP27 in our work in climate adaptation and climate change, is that we need better soil health mapping, of which the technology has changed pretty dramatically and has come down 97% in the cost to map soil health through satellite imaging. Two, we need to look at new R&D approaches, so biostimulants, certain kinds of nitrogen fixation of which we invest in, but we can't get around the actual dependency we have and the lack of fertilizer usage in sub-Saharan Africa. So average usage around the world, okay, I'm gonna, you will know my, the numbers better, is probably at 137 kilograms per hectare. Africa, Tanzania, 16 kilograms per hectare. Kenya must be 30 to 50, something like that. Average in Africa is around 20 some. So unless we actually understand that the countries that have contributed least to climate change, being sub-Saharan Africa, are suffering the most, and the current crisis is actually lowering their ability to have this mobility out of poverty, unless we fix those twin things and do it in a biodiverse, sustainable way, I don't see how this progress continues in what we've seen in our lifetime. And so we're interested in that, in the public goods around soil health and mapping, weather mapping and predictability around that, and upstream R&D on new technology for drought tolerance, pest and disease control, and neglected crops that have not been invested in. So we think those platforms are powerful as public goods, and we think the genetics behind that actually should be open and available so that we can work collectively on it.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Roger. So I'd like to go back to Rick. So Rick, you live and work in the United States. The country has energy, the country has land, the country can produce food, the country can produce a lot of things for a lot of people, but we all need to do it sustainably. And your office works with us on the scope 3 emissions for the industry, which all lies in new technologies, in doing things better. So tell us a bit about how you view sustainability in the industry and what the US is doing on a global fertilizer challenge in terms of driving a little bit deeper, both the reuse of nutrients and use of nutrients better.
Yeah, thank you. So I won't attempt to go deep into the technology questions because I will not be able to do better than this panel. But what I can tell you is that we worked with these partner governments to pull together this $135 million global fertilizer challenge, exceeding our $100 million goal, because we see that we need to tackle this problem on at least three levels. The first is the question of soil health and efficiency of fertilizer use. The second level is we need to think about the transition past conventional fertilizers towards green ammonia and other kinds of production of fertilizer that is lower emissions intensity in the production of the product itself. And we're far down the track in that regard with our own incentives under recent legislation in the United States that will create extraordinary investment, that is creating extraordinary investment in renewable electricity, in the green hydrogen that is the precursor for green ammonia. Yeah. And the incentives there through a range of tax credits will enjoy bipartisan support and will be sustained for a decade and will be a real kickstart to the United States being at the forefront of that transition. And then finally, we need to think about some of these advanced solutions that involve new technologies like on-site fertilizer production or things that can be done to do better on crop selection and genetics in order to allow for more nitrogen fixation and other such solutions in the fields themselves. And we're doing all of that through the work of the U.S. Department of Agriculture on a broad 500 million plus research and development agenda, But also we're doing it internationally through efforts like the Agricultural Innovation Mission for Climate, where we encourage private sector partners and actions, where we are encouraging other governments to step up in a similar way and work together on this shared agenda of developing these innovations that we need to really properly address this in coming years and even decades. Because the challenge is becoming more acute. The track record is extraordinarily positive, but we need to make sure we keep the innovation going, that we actually stay ahead of the curve in terms of remaining population growth and then cleaning up this sector at the same time that we ensure sustained and even increased agricultural productivity gains. I just want to briefly note one more thing, which is that this is a year in which we have new commitment in Amazonia to address deforestation reduction in DRC, in other geographies. And of course, stopping tropical deforestation is one of the main things we have to do to solve climate change. And underlying that has to be agricultural productivity. And of course, fertilizer efficiency and adequate fertilizer application is one of the ways to make that happen. So yeah. Lots of these things weave together, and we have to keep at it with the weaving together.
No, this is great. You opened so many avenues to explore, but I'd like to go to Svein Tore now. So Svein Tore keeps telling me that our industry is not hard to decarbonize, it's just costly to decarbonize. And what Rick just described is, you know, what the United States have done, which is carrots instead of sticks. I wouldn't call it green ammonia or blue or whatever. I would call it lower carbon hydrogen ammonia. So any thoughts on how this is going to progress and whether it's hard or just costly and we can deal with it financially?
Well, we have all the technologies, so it's about applying those technologies, whether that's carbon capture and storage or changing from using natural gas to electrolyzers to produce green hydrogen. All this is doable, but as you say, it's costly. What the US has done now with the Inflation Reduction Act is a complete game changer. That is working together with the private sector to decarbonize, to put incentives in place to drive this change. And this is happening right now, and that's great. It's also a major wake-up call. And I spent some time in Brussels last week that now Europe needs to get its act together as well and not complain about this, but rather see that this is a necessary change and speed up and copy what the US is doing to work together with the industry to decarbonize. And that has several impacts. One is to reduce emissions from the industry, which is important, but it's also about reducing the dependency on natural gas. And we've seen that firsthand here in Europe, what it means to be dependent on natural gas, and from Russia in particular, with 40% of the natural gas a couple of years ago coming from Russia, and now a very small amount, and we see the impact to industry, and that means that a large part of the industry in Europe right now is struggling, both because of energy prices, but also because the regulatory environment and the incentives to drive the change is so much less advantageous than in the US. It's more the stick than the carrot, and we need to change that. And now we talked about the importance of fertilizer, and that's important for all regions to have a certain supply of product. So this morning I saw I was on some of the headlines in BBC on how Putin has weaponized food as well. This is not a war only fought with military weapons, it's with energy, we've already seen that. But it's also on food and energy. And who do we want to be dependent on? Russia is not only a big producer of natural gas and oil, they're also a big producer of food and fertilizer. In fact, the biggest exporter of fertilizer. Do we want to be dependent on that going forward as well when we see what we've seen? I think we need to be very much aware of that.
Right. Thank you, Svein Tore. So, Minister Trondheim, I'd like to go to you now. So, Svein Tore talks about dependencies, and we have seen how, especially Sub-Saharan Africa, but also Middle East and North Africa, is dependent on soft commodities, if I were to say that, from Ukraine, so wheat, barley, etc., but also on fertilizers out of the region. So, what can international development community do today to make sure that we do have food security in Sub-Saharan Africa, in Central America, in Asia? What would you, as a minister, and what do you talk to other ministers of development talk about when it comes to food security on the continent in Africa?
Whenever I talk about this with my colleagues in Africa, politicians in Africa, you know, they say the same thing. We want investments in agriculture in order to become more self-sufficient. And I think it's absolutely absurd that the African continent imports foodstuffs worth some $60 billion a year, when we know the resources in on the continent, and with you know, available technology, and investments in you know, ready techniques, African agriculture can be a motor of development and prosperity. You know, we're talking about fertilizers. I come from a farmer's background myself, and even you know, in back home in a country like Norway, farmers are saying, you know, we're not sure we're going to be able to afford fertilizers. You know, we might not be able to put seeds in the ground this year because we don't have the liquidity to buy fertilizers. Now imagine the billions of small-scale farmers in Africa even more dependent on that those nutrients to be able to produce anything at all. And I want to look at, you know, the potential for business in this as well. You know, all these billions of small-scale self-subsistence farmers in Africa are actually businessmen and businesswomen, and fertilizer is, you know, one necessary input. What we need to do is create value chains around these small-scale farmers on the inputs. Fertilizer seeds, etc., but also getting that foodstuffs to the local markets to make sure that we create local regional value chains on their own resources. That is what African politicians want. They have the plans. They need investments. So I just think it's really exciting and many opportunities, and it's up for the grabs. And you were talking about localized fertilizer production. And that's coming as well. You know, we need to produce a lot more of those basic inputs on the African continent. And that is also necessary in order to tailor make the fertilizers for the soil quality on each spot. So, you know, that's the future, I'm sure of it.
Thank you, Minister. What is enlightening to hear in this forum is that it's not about aid to Africa. It's about building businesses. It's about investments that actually yield new investments. It's about the proverbial, let's not give a fish, let's teach how to fish. This is really, really enlightening. Roger, your organization does a lot of work in agriculture in Africa. You're supporting Agra, you're supporting many other outfits. Any words of wisdom on what else needs to be done in Africa, building on a minister's comments?
I don't know if I have words of wisdom. So the foundation, the largest single program we have is in agriculture. And it's because we believe it's an engine for mobility out of poverty, but it's a way that labor is off-taken to other more productive areas. And so it's really important. Our goal is not just to create bigger farmers. It's actually to create more productivity that allows labor to be freed up in other areas as well and grow the economy. Saying that, the challenge in Africa is deforestation, grassland preservation, natural systems. And you're going to have to do that through intensification, and that's going to take investment in new technology. And so for us, there are sort of four or five things that we think are important. One is to get the right policy environment right in Africa that's actually workable for smallholder farmers, and especially women, who the productivity gap for women can be more than double it is for men, and certainly well below what it should be in the yield equivalent. And that's one of the reasons we invest in Agra and others is on that policy front. Two is to get the right infrastructure. Extension services make a big difference. Digital extension services are really powerful, and we've seen great growth in that. And the investment in these sectors actually has probably a 3 times bigger effect than investment in any other sector for mobility out of poverty. And if you invest in the next area, which is research and development, where I think we're way behind the curve on it, it has a 10-to-1 return, according to the recent figures that were put out around the CGIAR. And so we think there needs to be new investment, especially in neglected crops outside the big five. And that's cassava, teff, other things that we haven't seen. And then lastly, it's actually to think about what the trade relationship is, what the investment is, and what's the private-public partnership that should be there. And I think our partnerships with governments like Norway, as governments like the United States around this have been incredibly productive, but also the private sector relationship. And so what we're trying to do as a foundation is to say, look, everyone deserves a life to a healthy and productive life. And in sub-Saharan Africa, agriculture is going to be key to that.
Thank you, Roger. And I'd like to give a shout out to your support of Sustain Africa, which is an initiative to help farmers. Very much appreciate. So one of our panel participants will have to leave in a few minutes, Rick. So I'd like to give you an opportunity to share some last words with the audience. If Davos were to be successful for you in your mission, what would it look like and what would you have achieved? What would you take home when you leave at the end of the week?
I don't think we can put this all on one meeting here in Davos, but let me just lay out how we think about the broader challenge of climate and where fertilizer fits into that. And I want to just highlight some of these synergies. When we tackle fertilizer in a strategic way, we are addressing climate change in a strategic way. And broadly, what we need to do, of course, is complete the energy transition by mid-century. We need to stop tropical deforestation. We need to scale up carbon management. And we need to address non-CO2 emissions, including methane. And in different ways, this agenda weaves together. We've already talked about this regarding intensification of agriculture, agricultural productivity, as the way to allow countries to have economic growth and food security at the same time that they preserve important habitats like tropical forests. That's crucial, and that's a real opportunity where this community can make a major difference over time with the investments like the Fertilizer Challenge, with government's investments in R&D, with philanthropic sector at the table as well, and in a sustained way helping. But there are also interesting ways that you can even address things like methane while you're at it. So look at what's going on in a country like Brazil, where President Lula is deeply committed to this agenda, a lifelong commitment to stopping tropical deforestation. For that to happen, it's going to require tackling fertilizer use and getting efficient and sufficient fertilizer use to intensify agriculture in Brazil and preserve that land. It's also going to require things like livestock productivity. And when you do that right, you, in some cases, might be using that those same crops as feed and making sure you have the right nutrition for livestock. And when you are down that track, you're also cutting the methane intensity per kilo of beef, for example. So this is an agenda where synergies are everywhere. And what we need to see is the kind of creativity that the Fertilizer Challenge is bringing. And I'll just note that one of the first areas where the United States is going to commit its resources under that effort is in Brazil, because we do see this opportunity. We'll also be working in Vietnam and Pakistan and Colombia. And so eager for making this all as real as possible, as quickly as possible, and making sure that we identify what else needs to happen and that we mobilize, especially government resources, to really get the innovation done at the scale required, the pace required, and the agricultural extension that we need in order to reach the smallholders. And of course, we're going to need large-scale private sector investment to engage in the fertilizer sector, but also in the broadly defined agricultural sector at the same time. So Davos is a good place to be having this conversation, and I'm really grateful for the chance to have been a part of it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Rick. So I know you have to run, so we are going to switch colleagues on a stage. Thank you, Rick. Great working with you. I'd like to invite Sir David Navarro, to come on a stage and share with us some special remarks. And then we're going to open to a Q&A from the audience. Thank you, David.
Thank you very much indeed, Alzbeta. My name is David Navarro, and I'm the alternate for the very senior guest that we were going to have now, who is, I think, not coming.
You are never an alternate.
Thank you very much.
welcome.
Well, I wanted to tell you that my reason for being here is that I am leading the food work stream of the United Nations Secretary General's Global Crisis Response Group. And Minister referred to the Secretary General of the UN just now. And I want to say how, personally, how wonderful that discussion for the last half hour has been, because it's reminded us that approaching fertilizers has to be done in a multifaceted way, because each of us will see the challenge a bit differently. You heard about farmers cutting back their sowing. We know that's been happening all over the world. You heard about poorer farmers finding it almost impossible to access the fertilizer they need. But at the same time, you will have heard between the lines that there are big concerns about the efficiency with which fertilizers are used and about the whole sustainability of application of particularly chemical fertilizers. We didn't hear much about another problem, which is that the fertilizer markets in many countries don't work right. They're quite easily distorted, especially when fertilizers are made available suddenly, perhaps at low cost. That tends to lead to inappropriate behavior and may even lead to fertilizers being used for political purposes, and the word weaponization was used in the discussion. So one has a really interesting two-sided situation. On the one hand, a super important substance or set of substances that, if not available for small-scale farmers, indeed if not available for farmers, will lead to farmer impoverishment and lower production quite dramatically. And at the same time, an area where, if interventions are not done really carefully, then a series of distortions and even quite destructive activity may happen. And all the time, there's the spectre of inappropriate use surrounding us. So what's emerging? First of all, you heard a panel consisting of people from industry, people from governments, and people from philanthropy saying very clearly that for them, they want to focus on soil health, soil nutrition. You're almost changing the nature of the discourse quite subtly, but quite importantly. It's not about fertilizer, it's about soil health. Perhaps next year, a session like this won't be called Global Fertilizer Challenge, it'll be called the Soil Health Challenge. Secondly, we're thinking about how to enable small-scale producers to access what they need, perhaps as part of a package. Thirdly, we're thinking about innovation. Fourthly, we're linking it all to climate. So, as well as dealing with the core issues of access and affordability and sustainability, we're looking at a large number of other issues all around. Can this kind of complex issue really be dealt with effectively when there are many hundreds of actors involved in it without some central strategic point which helps everybody to get into the same space? I was listening to Mr. Duke, I was listening to all the other panelists, and I was thinking, is there anybody holding this together? And I thought, actually, we are very, very blessed at the moment with the leadership and the composition of the International Fertilizer Association. I've been able to work with them since April, May last year, but it intensified because we established a fertilizer working group out of the Global Crisis Response Group of the UN. And at the heart of that group has been the International Fertilizer Association. And so my request from now on is that we, all of us, work with the IFA, and we work with those international actors like the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, like the government of Norway, and we work with the industry to spend quite a lot of time getting strategic harmonization, because otherwise this will become and continue to be too messy. That's my request. Now, this is also, last point, a very unstable area. I'm a systems thinker, and as a systems thinker, I'm always looking for the possibility that a new way of thinking and working will emerge out of a messy situation. What do you need for that to happen? Firstly, you need a lot of energy. Secondly, you need a major disturbance. And thirdly, you need the issue to be amplified repeatedly. That's the kind of three factors that tend to lead to emergence of new ways of doing things in systems. Well, we have the energy. Masses and masses of interest, as you've heard. Secondly, there is a disturbance, particularly as a result of the change in the Russian fertilizer access. And thirdly, there is an amplification in these kinds of sessions. We've got more and more people being involved. So this is actually a very positive space for a new way of thinking and working to emerge. New name, new actors, new principles, new standards. And I'm actually thinking that the whole area of soil nutrition will look completely different in 2 or 3 years' time. Thank you, Elspeth.
Thank you very much, David, and thank you for your kind words for this system transformation. Long time ago, I spoke to David about this issue. Long time ago, 6 months ago. And he calls this a wicked problem because it's a problem that doesn't have an easy solution. If there was an easy solution, we wouldn't have this panel here. We would be thinking about it. We would have been done already. So with this, thank you. Please stay here. I'd like to open the forum for questions from the audience. Please stand up, and I believe there is a handheld mic that you can get. Right here, one, two, first row, second, two in the first row and one at the back. Please introduce yourself if you could.
Yeah, I can. So my name is Tina Fano. I'm working for Novozymes. I have a question in terms of all the things you're talking about and the need for regionalized and also local production of fertilizers. What do you think should be done in terms of securing that we have a regulatory framework supporting these new innovations? Biotech, which I represent, is one of the areas which could be supporting in situ, for example, nitrogen production or phosphorus release from soils. However, right now, at least in the EU, the regulatory frameworks are not securing support for innovative solutions. So what is your thinking and what should be done in order to overcome that challenge?
Great, thank you. We'll take two more questions here and then we go to the panel. There are these two, front row, two questions here. And then we'll do the second round. We have time to do another round, so no worries.
Eric Fuhrwald with Syngenta. My question is to Sven Tora about the reliance on Russia. How do we get away from that? What's your view?
Thank you.
My question is actually, I really love the long term, but please, we are food secure today. So my question to the panel is, what are we going to do tomorrow to make sure that we still get that gap until we have this long-term resilience? Today, we have hunger. So please also look at that.
Thank you, Barry. So let's go to the panel. So Roger, do you want to tackle some of the long-term food security? And then we go to Sven Tore, and then we see who else picks up the rest.
So three things for me and for the long-term. Look, we need to do again what was done in the last generation, which is improve food productivity pretty dramatically. And we need a regulatory framework that is going to prioritize investment in research and development, as well as soil health, and do that in a way that's more sustainable than it was done last time. And we're seeing emerging places that's happening. So USDA can invest in internationally before it could not. There's the CGIAR, which I think is probably one of the best public goods available in the world in terms of return for value. But it also means this kind of public-private sector in both biotechnology, soil health, but also in really novel upstream ways that we're going to think about nitrogen fixation, local production of nitrogen, but also plant capability. And I think there are some really emerging technology. Novozymes is doing some really amazing things that really need the framework so that people safely feel like they know how to trial this and know how to roll it out. for long term, for productivity, I think we actually, unlike many other areas of development, like how do you solve HIV, how do you solve malaria, we actually understand what needs to be done, and it's actually getting the alignment of the architecture and the financing structures to do that. I think part of that relies on our friends in Africa getting the right regulatory environment and policy environment, which we don't quite have yet, although we're seeing emerging, and we're seeing some innovation in that. And then secondly, it's actually greater global cooperation on the R&D and on the deployment front. So in the last few years, the Excellence in Breeding Program have dropped the number of years for new cassava development from 8 years to 4 years. That's one of the kinds of innovation that needs to happen. Now we need a regulatory approval of how those new crops get approved and into the ground. And I could go on it, but I won't. I'll leave others.
Minister Twineram, anything on the global sort of long-term systemic transformation that Barry alluded to? Anything to add on this? Kind of what needs to be done long-term?
Long-term
food
and
security,
short-term,
right? Short-term. Yes. And short-term too.
We have to do it in parallel, and you're quite right. There are humanitarian needs as we speak. So we need to address the humanitarian short-term needs, and that's basically well-known humanitarian support. The other issue, of course, is to access. We know that there are lots of food storage out there. We know that there are some countries in the world with a lot of food on store that should be accessed in this situation. I'm not going to elaborate more on that. I think you all know what I'm talking about. So I hear your concern, but I must admit that my concern has rather been that we are focusing too much on the immediate humanitarian concerns, forgetting the transitional long-term term work. But we have to do both.
Thank you, Minister. So let me go to Svein Tore. So the question was about how do we
I'm anxious to hear this answer.
less dependent on Russia, but I don't think it's just about Russia. It's about less dependent on any one actor. Yep. Today is Russia, tomorrow it can be somebody else. How do we make sure that the trade system works? And also, how do we make sure that the countries don't hoard fertilizer? You don't need it for the whole year. You need it for a season. Can we stop hoarding it? Can we use it efficiently around the world? So over to you, Svein.
Indeed, and it starts with the awareness of how the food system actually works, and we've learned some very important lessons in the last 2 to 3 years that we got in a food system that we, or the food system that we paid for, lowest possible cost, maximum amount of crops, but we didn't take into account how vulnerable it was first on the logistics side of it with bottlenecks that we saw during COVID. We see how climate vulnerable it is as well, and now we see how politically exposed it is. And we heard from the Secretary General of NATO just a couple of weeks ago, where he said that business is too important only to leave it up to business leaders to make these decisions. And I think he has a point that we need to think about this in terms of security as well. And Russia will still be a major fertilizer producer. They have the raw materials and so on. But to allow ourselves to be in a situation where we're at the mercy of Russia on access to fertilizer to the extent that we are right now is not acceptable. And to be too dependent on single countries is too big a risk. Then how do we solve it? Well, part of it is doing what the U.S. is doing right now to support the industry to build additional capacity. I think Europe needs to do more to safeguard its infrastructure because it's suffering both on energy and the lack of incentives for transition right now. And then it's to do large-scale rollout of renewable energy, to use green hydrogen to produce fertilizers. It's about what was touched upon on using technology to make sure we have higher nutrient use efficiency as well, make every nutrient count using technology to drive this, but all the time being aware of what kind of risk is really in the system, and not only think about next quarter's prices, but really the long-term impact of it. And we see right now the price of being unprepared for this crisis and what that means for productivity and affordability of fertilizers. We cannot allow that to happen again.
Thank you, Sventora. And the answer to the question on local production, would it be in going green in sort of small scale, small batch green ammonia? Is that the answer to going local?
Today we're not able to do that at small scale yet, but green ammonia can make production available possible in parts of the world where it was not possible before, because then it was much more linked to where do you have cheap fossil energy. So now you can look at where do you have sun, or where do you have hydropower, or where do you have wind power. So it changes it, and it could make a more distributed production of ammonia.
To David, then we are going to go see if there's any one question, and then we do a quick lightning round to close the session. David.
So Barry Martin said there is an acute problem, and we have seen that farmers, particularly in West Africa, have cut back on planting really quite massively in the last few months. So I would like to suggest that it's farmer access to fertilizer in the short term that needs to be the issue, rather than fertilizer itself. Because if the concentration is on fertilizer, the response may be to start moving ships containing various forms of fertilizer to different countries. But if it's done clumsily, then that can really wreck the market. And Yara and other companies have been very careful on this. Secondly, some people say to me, is there any other challenge as tricky as fertilizer in international development at the moment? And I say, I think antimicrobial resistance, which I deal with my health hat on, has some similarities. You have these very valuable and quite scarce products that can achieve miraculous results. But if they're not used right, that has both immediate and long-term impact. Now, I just want to say antimicrobial resistance has been really tough to handle, but in the end, it does require bringing together all the different actors in a constant way. Thank you, Sven, Tori, and Yara.
So we don't have time for more questions, but you can add your point now. So I would like to do one quick lightning round. We have 90 seconds. If there is one thing that you'd like to tell everyone else in Davos that would make a difference to this topic, and if you'd like one more company, person, organization to come to this table to help us solve the challenge. We start with you, Roger.
Oh, so I would say that to add to David's point on the sustainability, getting fertilizer to the people who are in most need, who've done the least to contribute to it, is really key, and I think that's what Sustain Africa and the IFA have done really effectively. I think one partner that I wish we had more and deeper engagement is actually China on this issue, and they would be the ones that I would want even a deeper engagement on. And I think that they have a big role to play, and hope to see them play a more productive role.
So in preparing for this week here in Davos, I had my first Twitter live event with 500 young African farmers. And I think, you know, in order to utilize technology and drive this productivity, let's bring the youth to the table and to help them also with financing and driving their businesses. I think that'll be an important key to driving this forward.
Thank you. The food system globally needs to be transformed. It's broken today. The Paris Agreement clearly states that we need to address the climate issue without threatening food production. And I must say that farmers around the world, whether in Norway or in Africa, sometimes get the sense that their job, producing food for the world, is the problem of climate change. But it can also be the solution. And part of the solution is on the fertilizer side. So, you know, if we can just join forces and make sure that food production becomes part of the solution on the climate challenge and not the problem.
Thank you, Minister. And David, you have the last word.
Just continue working together in this.
Good catch. Good catch.
That was filmed. Can we please continue working together in this style with amazing business leaders like Sven Tore and others, but with the IFA, with the foundation, and very much with governments. Let's have a few more farmers in the room as well, but we've had that virtually. It's only through the constant work of the kind that we're doing at the moment that we'll be able to deal with this, because it is, as I said, wickedly complex. Thank you for leadership.
Thank you, David. Please join me in a round of applause to this esteemed panel. Thank you for joining us. Thank you very much.